Professor Makgoba, the Eskom chairman, to introduce the ministers, Mr. Pravin Gordhan, who is joining us online, Ronald Lamola, who is with us here, and Mothibi of the SIU and André de Ruyter of Eskom. Thank you, sir.
Program Director, distinguished guests and compatriots, the media, ladies and gentlemen, it's my singular honor as the chairperson of Eskom to introduce and open this gathering. And because there are people who will tell you the full story. After a lengthy investigation and negotiations, Eskom and the Special Investigating Unit have reached an agreement with ABB South Africa, in terms of which ABB South Africa will pay Eskom 1.56 billion in full and final settlement of an overpayment dispute relating to a contract that was unlawfully awarded through corrupt means for work at the Kusile Power Station. The settlement is inclusive of the capital amount and interest. The agreement will be subject to the review of the High Court. On this platform and media statement, we have the Honorable Minister Ronald Ozi Lamola, the Minister of Justice and Correctional Services, and he will be followed by my minister, Minister Pravin Gordhan, the Minister of Public Enterprises. They will tell you the full story that will be initiated by Mr. Mothibi, the head of the SIU, and André de Ruyter, the CEO of Eskom. Ladies and gentlemen, I think this is the beginning of a story of recovering money that was stolen from the public through corrupt means, and obviously this is a good day for Eskom and for the public of South Africa. On that note, I will hand over to the director of the program to take us through the program. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Makgoba. Mr. Andy Mothibi, I will not be coming back here again until Mr. de Ruyter has spoken, and in the order the Prof has just mentioned, the ministers will speak. My colleague Kaiser Khanyaho will come and do the question and answers after this. Thank you, Mr. Mothibi.
Honorable Minister, Minister Lamola, the Minister of Justice and Correctional Services, Honorable Minister Gordhan, online, the Chairperson of the Eskom Board, Dr. Makgoba, the Group CEO of Eskom, Mr. André de Ruyter, my colleagues from the Department of Justice and from SIU and from Eskom, members of the media, I greet you. I'm here really to give you the background, in a sense outlining how we got to be where we are today, where we signed this significant agreement to recover a significant amount on behalf of Eskom. So the SIU investigated this matter in terms of proclamation R11 of 2018. Of course, the proclamation was issued in April after the president signed it. When the proclamation is signed, the team at SIU gets the preparation underway. We get the resources necessary, and the investigation hits the ground. So we started that. The investigation effectively kicked off in this on this aspect today, in August of 2018. During our investigation, the SIU interacted, of course, based on the aspect that we were investigating that affected ABB. We interacted with ABB. And the nature of the interaction was, of course, that we confront them with the allegations that we were investigating. So at that time, I need to just mention that already our colleagues at the DPCI, which is the Directorate for Priority of Investigations, were already investigating a matter that related to this aspect. So we also interacted with the Hawks because the investigations, the criminal investigations, are prosecutor-led or guided, prosecutor-guided. I think that's the correct terminology. We also interacted with the NPA in the process. But I need to also mention that due to the nature of the investigation and the interjurisdictional nature of it, we also interacted with the United States Securities and Exchange Commission. We also interacted with the United States Department of Justice. And we also interacted with the FBI, which is the Federal Bureau of Investigations. During the investigations, we of course continued to interact with ABB. During this interaction, amongst others, as ABB was aware of the nature of our investigation, they approached our investigators, they approached SIU. The nature of this approach was that, having understood the focus area of what we were investigating, they needed to, you know, do some investigation internally on their side. And once they were still continuing to do that, of course, we were also continuing to investigate. The ABB committed to cooperate with the criminal investigation and with the SIU investigation. The SIU facilitated meetings between ABB and Eskom, simply because at that stage, the ABB was beginning to indicate to the investigators, and these are the SIU investigators, that they themselves have found internally that there are irregularities, which points, and also activities that point to the corrupt way in which the ABB contract was acquired or issued to them by Eskom. As I indicated, the ABB then continued to cooperate. They even, you know, provided us with some witness statements. We have been liaising with the United States, as I said, Securities Exchange Commission and the Department of Justice. They requested to be kept in the loop relating to the cooperation that we received from ABB, and that they requested, of course, based on some of the obligations that they may have on their side, whether they would consider, because remember, you know, every country has got its own laws and regulations. There are laws on their side that would enjoin them to understand the investigations against ABB, just so that they can make whatever decisions that's appropriate on their side. We've also found that some of the witnesses related to these investigations are foreign, they're in the foreign jurisdictions, and we continue to interact with them. SIU conducted its own detailed investigation into the Eskom procurement process and approval variation by Eskom officials, and we continue to share the information where appropriate. If it does impact on the criminal side, we do then cooperate or input or on the side of the criminal investigations. Right, having reached this stage where ABB has made these findings on their part, and on our side, the investigations was also pointing to irregularity. The ABB then approached the SIU team with an offer of settlement. And of course, because we are investigating the state institution being Eskom, in the normal run of our investigation, if any party that against whom we are investigating, of course, realizes that evidence points to wrongdoing on their part, we've experienced it over time that they do come forward and offer the settlement. We engaged with Eskom, and this settlement related to aspects of the contract which they had to do some work at the Kusile power station. So without really going into much detail, as the criminal investigation is still going on, we then started to really quantify what is it that really the offer to settlement relates to. There were some evidence pointed to, you know, overpayments, and we started, SIU, Eskom, and ABB started to work together to quantify all of this that could have been lost by Eskom. And the quantification was so intense that we even had to, you know, rely on the experts that are knowledgeable on the work that the ABB has done. But needless to say, that that process led us to where all the parties agreed to an amount. And that amount, the group CEO of Eskom will probably break it down, but we ultimately reached a settlement on an amount of 1.557107009, 1.5 billion that will be paid back to Eskom by ABB. We are really thrilled to see this kind of significant recovery on behalf of Eskom. So, just high level, the SIU, Eskom, and ABB agreed as follows. The SIU and Eskom have a duty to institute the review application to set aside this contract that we are investigating. As I indicated, it was clear from the evidence, and also ABB by themselves agreeing that it was acquired irregularly and on a corrupt basis. So we've got a duty as the special investigating unit in terms of our legislation to institute civil litigation. Of course, we will do that jointly with Eskom as a party to the civil litigation. So that process will proceed. We envisage, honorable ministers and colleagues, that the papers for this review will be launched early in the new year. I quizzed my colleagues that early in the new year is too general, is not a specific timeline, but I was assured, Minister, that we actually had aimed to issue those papers today. But simply because of other processes, we could not, and the special tribunal is taking recess from today. So we will then have those papers ready to be issued probably in January or February of next year. And we've also agreed that ABB shall no later than 14 days after signing their settlement make this payment into the Eskom interest-bearing bank account. As I said, this is money in Eskom's account that could, of course, be used as appropriate, and I'm sure the CEO may indicate on that it would be used for in the interest of Eskom. So, in terms of our investigations, and as we always inform the public, that when we investigate, we seek to reach these main outcomes. The first outcome is that when we find, like in this case, that the contract has been awarded irregularly and that there's also corruption, those matters get investigated, and we've got the duty to take the contract to the court or special tribunal in this case to set it aside and get the contract cancelled. There's also a duty that we refer the matters to criminal investigation. As I indicated, the docket is already opened and that matter is under investigation. But there's also a duty that when we make these findings, we also check internally and of course externally who are those officials that are responsible for this wrongdoing. So we have made the finding of the executives that were responsible. The investigation has shown that they actually have since left the organization. But I indicated to my colleagues that, as we always say, resignation from employment only terminates employer-employee relationship. We will pursue them civilly, on civil litigation. If there's any indication that they have caused damage to Eskom, we will pursue them. And of course, as I indicated, criminal investigation is ongoing. So let's allow that process to proceed, and at an appropriate time, the decision will be made to get them to account criminally. We also, excuse me, we also, I've indicated that civil proceedings are continuing. Criminal investigations are pursuing the disciplinary processes. Because of the law, now Eskom can really not act on those. But the investigations are ongoing. If evidence points to other officials that are internal, we will, of course, point that to Eskom and we'll make sure that action is taken. I'm going to pause here. Honorable Minister Lamola, Honorable Minister Gordhan, and the colleagues and the members of the media, I will hand over then to the Group CEO of Eskom, Mr. de Ruyter. Thank you.
Right, good afternoon. Thank you, Advocate Mothibi, for that introduction. Good afternoon, Minister Gordhan, Minister Lamola, Professor Makoba, and also then Advocate Mothibi and other members of the SIU and members of the media and Eskom colleagues who are here with me today. We're very pleased, obviously, with the recovery that we have seen. The agreement between ABB, Eskom, and the SIU was signed this morning at 10 o'clock between representatives of the three entities at Megawatt Park. So this is hot off the press. It is anticipated that Eskom will receive proceeds of the settlement offer before the end of this calendar year, so it is imminent. The claim originated as a result of a tender for control and instrumentation work at Kusile Power Station, so-called Work Package 21A. This was awarded to ABB on the 29th of April 2015 for a total amount of 2.214 billion rand. This was 324 million rand more than the price offered by the lowest bidder. At the time, it was motivated to award the contract to ABB on the basis that ABB could offer schedule acceleration. And I think subsequent events have proven that there were other motives. So to date on this contract, Eskom has paid to ABB some 3.1 billion rand. The settlement amount is made up of irregular variation orders to the amount of 800 million. Costs associated with the irregular award of the contract due to collusion with certain Eskom officials, 215 million rand. Interest on the money that was paid over irregularly to ABB of 380 million rand. And a profit element that accrued to ABB of 160 million rand. So that adds up to the total settlement amount of 1.557 billion rand that ABB has committed in terms of the settlement agreement to now repay. Now, we accept that ABB has performed work for which we have received value, and therefore we have not claimed back the entire contract amount. We have sought to claim back the amount that was irregularly enriching of ABB and was therefore unlawful. The challenge that we now have, of course, is that Kusile is an ongoing project. The work on this power station in terms of this CNI control and instrumentation project is about 90% complete. And for Eskom to now approach the market and appoint a new contractor with different technology will probably cause us to incur a delay in the commissioning of Kusile, which is already late, of a further 4 years. It will create a real risk of claims from other contractors for standing time amounting to about a billion rand, and it will substantially increase the risk of load shedding over the next 4 years. So we are going to be approaching National Treasury with a request to approve that we continue with the execution of this work with ABB, with the proviso that ABB will make no profit on the continued execution of this contract, having repaid already, obviously, that profit element. We are obviously delighted at this outcome. I think it is a continuation of a long series of recoveries. We have recovered 1.1 billion rand from McKinsey. We've recovered 171 million rand from Deloitte Consulting. We are pursuing a claim for 93 million from PwC. We have recently launched a civil claim to recover 3.8 billion rand from members of the Gupta family and other associates, and that claim is making its way through the courts. So as the management and board of Eskom, we are committed to pursuing those who sought to enrich themselves unlawfully at the expense of Eskom and also at the expense of the South African taxpayer and the electricity consumer. If I may, I would like to recognize particular individuals who've worked extraordinary hours to come to a landing on this long and extended series of negotiations. From the SIU side, I think in particular Claudia O'Brien and Gerard Fisaghi were instrumental in delivering this result. And from the Eskom side, in particular, Jan Uber also was quite tenacious, I have to say, in pushing for an ever higher number. So thanks to that dedication and commitment, we really appreciate it. We will continue with the process of recovery. It's a long way to go. You may ask, what is going to happen to the money? Will it make a dent in our debt? Unfortunately, the settlement amount is only 0.25% of the total Eskom debt. So while it's helpful in easing some of our liquidity constraints, it is not the solution that we are looking for. So with that, thank you very much, Chair, Minister, and I will now hand back to the Minister to take us further. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Director. I can speak for you.
Okay. And my colleague PG on the online platform, or virtually, Professor Mahova, the chairperson of Eskom, and Advocate Mothibi, the head of the SIU, and the CEO of Eskom. On behalf of President Ramaphosa, who stated in the State of the Nation address that the government will support all efforts to get back the money that has been stolen from the state coffers, and in terms of him also authorizing the SIU and giving a proclamation for this investigation, we see this as a groundbreaking in terms of our efforts to assist law enforcement agencies to get all the monies that have been stolen in the fiscus through malfeasance and through various agencies. And I want to congratulate the SIU and the Eskom for a sterling job in investigating and ensuring that what was stolen from the public purse is returned. This is happening during a period 2 days ago. It was we were marking the International Day against Anti-Corruption Day under the theme Recover and Integrity. And it is a befitting marking of that day by recovering such huge amounts to the coffers. I can see Advocate Mothibi does not want to say it, but it is historic in that it is the biggest recovery ever by the SIU in the history since the SIU was constituted in terms of their act. So this is a significant development and groundbreaking. And it sends a very clear message to the people of our country about the commitment of government to assist the SIU and all other law enforcement agencies to do their job. Because we view as government corruption and maladministration as inconsistent with the rule of law and the fundamental values of our constitution, because it undermines the constitutional commitment to human rights, the achievement of equality, and the advancement of human rights and freedoms. It is an antithesis to an open, accountable, democratic government and required by the constitution. So it has to go checked, and we have to ensure that whoever is responsible for all the malfeasance has to be brought to book and must account. And in this regard, government will continue to give support to the SIU as and when it becomes necessary, because the SIU is a sui generis kind of an institution which operates through the presidential proclamation. And the president has consistently given support to the efforts and the work of the SIU. So I just wanted to give them that congratulatory message and to state that on behalf of the government and also on behalf of the president, our continued support will be guaranteed so that all efforts are not spared, are spared for all resources that were stolen from the fiscus and all monies that went through malfeasance from either Eskom, Transnet, or any state parastatal or any government department, it's recovered. Thank you. Oh, I must hand over to PG. Oh, okay. PG online, I don't know if you can hear me. They said I must hand over to you.
Very clearly. You have to hand over digitally, you see. Well, good afternoon, everyone. To my young colleague, Minister Lamola, Chair of the Eskom Board, Professor Makhoba, to Andy Mothibi, who I must say to you, Mr. Lamola, received his early training at the South African Revenue Service, so he must tell you more about it, to him as well, and his investigators, and the CEO of Eskom and the Eskom team that worked on this particular matter. Our sincere congratulations, as Minister Lamola said, both of the government and of the ministry itself. I think the review of contracts and the list that the CEO provided in respect of the recoveries that have already taken place in relation to McKinsey and Deloitte and PwC and the claims that have been issued in respect of the Gupta family and their associates, the former executives and board members, I would think, as well, who continue to mislead the public at the Rondo Commission, and a former minister that Mr. De Ruyter seems to have mentioned as well. These are just early examples of practical actions that are being taken, not just the theory and the words, in order to bring money back into the coffers. And although it will take a few years to actually do that, we need to actually ensure that more and more of this work is done and intensified indeed. This must also be put into the context of state capture. And clearly Eskom and other SOEs have been the targets of state capture. And in particular, the procurement system, key individuals within each of these entities and outside businesses and professionals, plus the treasuries of these institutions, have been the targets invariably of the kind of malfeasance that we are talking about today. We must congratulate the ABB management for the disclosure that they made on a voluntary basis. And I think this is an important signal to other businesses that if they've been involved intentionally or otherwise, in any form of malfeasance, corruption, or undermining the integrity, governance, and operations and financial status of SOEs, now is the time to come forward. Otherwise, Mr. Mothibi is going to find you in one way or another. There's another interesting lesson for all of these entities as well, and that is the range of international enforcement agencies that have become involved, particularly in respect of the role that international firms like ABB have played. So whilst you might be able to hide certain things in South Africa, there are other agencies that are involved in this process, and they will certainly have a deep interest in what is going on in our context. How much of all of this contributes to the difficulties that Eskom is experiencing in respect of load shedding or energy security more broadly is something that we must still evaluate. But there's no doubt that as South Africans, we should note that there is a relationship between the corruption and malfeasance that went on the one hand, and the kind of experiences that our businesses and citizens experience when there is load shedding taking place. So there's a long list of entities, and I'm sure there are many more, who have been involved in one or other state institution or state enterprise, whether it's Danel, Transnet, SAA, or the Revenue Service, PRASA, and many others. And the role of Bain, T-Systems, SAP, KPMG, McKinsey has been coming to the fore, Trillion, the Gupta family, others that have created firms in South Africa, but related to people who were in senior management within Eskom itself. If you put all of this together, there are billions of rands that need to be hunted down and brought back in, either into the fiscus or, in the case of Eskom, to the debt relief pot, if you like. But these investigations and charges and claims are also going to invite attacks, sometimes through the Bell-Pottinger mechanisms that were set up, the plethora of fake news outlets that actually exist, some of them operated by ex-employees and management within state-owned entities themselves. And sometimes when it is convenient and opportunistic, even the race card will be played in order to defend the malfeasance and to continue to get away with it. So in sum, this is a small contribution, as the CEO said, to the debt pot, but every billion rand that comes in is welcome, and I'm sure he agrees with that. But the message, finally, to firms that have been involved, professionals, lawyers, banks, financial advisors, and other types of operatives that have been involved in malfeasance, now is the time for you to approach the SIU and other agencies and make a voluntary disclosure using ABB as your example. Because the consequences, if you don't, will be that at some stage or the other, your role will be identified and described, and either through civil claims or through criminal charges, you will indeed face the music. Finally, I must compliment the board and the new management within Eskom for their courage, for their persistence, and for their resilience in continuing with this investigation and bringing it to the point that they have, together with, of course, the collaboration of the SIU and other law enforcement agencies on the one hand, but a management within ABB that was aware of its civil responsibilities as well. So congratulations to all concerned, and thank you very much.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Keiza Khanyako. I'm the spokesperson of the SIU. We are reaching a point where we go in to take questions. And in the meantime, while people are sending questions either via WhatsApp or on Teams, I'm going to allow the Minister of Justice, Minister Lamola, to say something. I was told it is something that you want to say. You're fine. Okay. We have got the two platforms that are available for us to take questions. And we having Takalani Mukwebo, who will be taking questions from the media through WhatsApp. And we've got Purina Dell and Teresa Magubani, who are going to be taking questions through MS Teams. I'm going to start. Do we have questions? Let me start here. You know the drill. Tell us who you are and where do you come from, and we will be able to take it further. Go next to the mic and then ask the question. Please indicate who you want the person that you want the answer from. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Barry Bateman from ENCA. Could you perhaps tell us more about the people who have been arrested in connection with this ABB? The over-invoicing, inflated invoices. I understand that at least two people have been arrested, but can you tell me more about these individuals? Were these the people inside Eskom? Were these people in ABB? What was the method of facilitating this criminal act? I'm not too sure who has that information, But could somebody answer it? Then as a following, and I say this with all due respect, are you not playing this up a little bit? I mean, it's great that you're recovering funds, but these are the people that are coming to you and say, here, take it. You know, somebody did something wrong in our company, please have it back. How about we hear about where companies are fighting not to give it back and we get victories there? I think that's where the real celebration should come in. So with all due respect, is this not being played up a bit? Thank you.
Okay. Can we have another question inside the house, if there is? Okay, in the absence of the question, do you have anything on WhatsApp, Takalani?
Thanks, Mr. Hanyahu. Right now, we don't have questions on WhatsApp. Thanks.
Okay. Anything from MS Teams?
I have just a few.
Okay, let's take at least two of them.
Okay, the first question is from Chris Yeland from EE Business Intelligence. He wants to know, he's actually asking Eskom, SIU and the Hawks to explicitly name the implicated corrupt former Eskom executives and officials, and not just the name of the contractor that is declaring a mea culpa and paying back 1.6 billion, which Eskom officials and all subcontractors were involved in the corrupt awarding of this contract. Will action be taken against them?
Okay.
And the second question is also from Chris Yeland. He is asking, does this corrupt contract relate in any way to Mr. Koko, his stepdaughter, and the company Impulse International, in which Mr. Koko's stepdaughter was a director and shareholder?
Thank you. I think we will take those questions now. First question, who are the people? Maybe I must give it to CEO Eskom. Oh, okay. Let's give it to Advocate Mothibi. No, you can do it.
Now, thank you very much for the question. As I indicated, that the criminal investigation is ongoing. I was briefed as latest as this morning by the investigating team. The DPCI, who are the lead criminal investigator, they're leading this investigation, and the information I received as of this morning that, of course, there's been some arrests in other areas of our investigation, but in this investigation itself, the information is that there hasn't been any arrests yet, and that investigation is ongoing. Of course, when it reaches that stage, the public will be aware. So there's a question that, and I'll really give my view, whether we're not playing this up. You know, this could really be akin, if you compare it to a criminal process, right? If anyone is arraigned, is arrested, brought to court, and pleads guilty, right? That plea of guilt has not come on its own. That is the result, in many instances, of intensive investigation, and there is a realization on the part of the accused in this example that the evidence is overwhelming and that they offer to plead guilty. I use that as an example because it's got all the hallmarks of what would have occurred here. During the investigation in my view, that for ABB, and we still do say they did the right thing, because they realized that the investigation is intense and it's revealing the irregularities that are related to this contract. So for me, it's that as part of that investigation, there would have been an awareness on the part of ABB, because remember they approached the SIU investigators during the investigation. And this contract dates back to before the proclamation, by the way. So for me, there is merit in really informing the public of the outcome of this nature. And as the minister indicated, it's a significant recovery on our part. In fact, in our books, this is the first of the largest amount that we have recovered to date. And I need to indicate that the investigations are ongoing. We've identified several areas of potential more recovery. Of course, I will not go into those details, but the point I'm making is that in no way are we overplaying this. There is no rationale to do that. What we are informing the public is the outcome of an intense investigation that focuses on dealing with maladministration, malfeasance, and corruption that occurred at Eskom. And I did indicate the question was also raised in terms of the officials who may have been involved. When I presented, I did say that we have pointed out, we've identified the officials that have been involved in this case. And because of the legal risks that are attendant in legal processes, because they have not been charged in any way, we would not be at liberty at this stage to mention their specific names. Thank you.
And there is a question about COCO while you are at it.
Let me first also just deal with the question on whether or not this is being played up. Bear in mind that the initial offer that was made was for a fairly derisory 25 million rand. And it is due to the efforts of Eskom officials and the SIU team that we managed to bump this number up to the 1.56 billion that you see before you today. So by no means has this been a slam dunk for the team. I think there's been an extraordinary amount of hard work and dedication that's gone into arriving at this particular settlement. And I can definitely testify to the commitment on the side of both the SIU and Eskom to bring this one over the line. In response to Chris Yellen's question, I don't want to again mention names. I think I'll leave that to those who are charged with bringing criminal prosecutions. That's not my sphere of competence. But I can confirm that one of the subcontractors of ABB on this particular contract was a company called Impulse, and that company, the stepdaughter of Mr. Coco, had a significant interest in that company. So that therefore is also subject to further investigation and a potential recovery claim.
Thank you very much. Do we have other questions back to MS Teams?
Yes, we do. This is from Antoinette Slabbert from Rapport. This is for Advocate Mothibi. Why is ABB not here today? And will ABB be blacklisted at National Treasury? Next question from Charlotte Matthews from Business Day. Do these investigations indicate there is a need to overhaul Eskom's tender system to make it criminal proof?
Okay. Anything from WhatsApp? Nothing at the moment. Is that all from MS Teams?
There is more.
Can you have for two more?
Two. From Miriam Issa, Finwick, can Eskom give us an idea as to the total amount of outstanding embezzled funds it is trying to recover? And from Sipilile Glutla, business report, this is for Mr. de Ruyter. If the agreement with ABB was signed this morning at 10 a.m., why are ABB representatives not part of this media briefing?
Thank you very much, Advocate Mothibi.
Thank you. With regard to why ABB is not part of the briefing, we deemed it appropriate that as part of a government initiative that we constitute this media briefing as we did. As it was indicated, they were at the venue where we signed the agreement. The agreement is signed by Eskom Special Investigating Unit and ABB. So there is no gray area there. It's confirmed, it's signed, and the money will be paid as agreed. With regard to the blacklisting, of course, the blacklisting is a very important aspect of our consequence management. And in particular, where we find that companies doing business with government, and this goes to show that contrary to the view that as government we only concentrate on corruption within the public sector or in government, we do at all times indicate that where there's private sector companies that are involved, we will act without hesitation. So having acted as we did, we are indeed considering the blacklisting process, which we will, because remember that's an administrative process, which in this case we have to engage with Eskom as the entity on whom this company was contracted, and the accounting authority of Eskom should be the ones that refer the company to National Treasury for blacklisting. Of course, that process is a recommendation from the Special Investigating Unit. So as an answer to that question, yes, we are considering that, and we will make sure that we process it to the National Treasury. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. de Ruyter.
Very much. If I can add to that, having regard to what I said earlier about the advanced state of completion of the work at Kusile, it is our opinion that unfortunately it would be impractical to blacklist ABB right now. If we have to remove them off-site, any new contractor would have to come in and redo all of the work. This is essentially a distributed control system that is being installed. So it is a bit like buying an Apple computer versus an IBM computer. The two are not interchangeable. So any new contractor would have to take out all of the equipment that had been installed. And that is why we anticipate that the total time to redo this with a new contractor would add 4 years to the completion of Kusile. It would also add R1 billion in potential claims that we would be exposed to from other contractors because of standing time, increase the risk of load shedding, and in our view, being 90% complete, we are now at the point where we need to finish this contract and get Kusile connected to the grid as soon as possible. And we will be engaging with National Treasury in this regard, and we have already corresponded with the National Treasury to this effect. If I can respond to Charlotte, I think criminal proof tender systems, yes, that is our ideal. That is where we want to go to. But I think what the experience of state capture has shown is that it's very difficult to design a system that is completely criminal proof and that can withstand the best efforts of those who have bad intentions to purloin funds from state institutions. The best defense at the end of the day are employees who are honest, loyal, committed. And that is why the rebuilding of Eskom and its values and its institutional framework is a critical part of our turnaround. The turnaround of Eskom is not only about rebuilding power stations and making sure that we put an end to load shedding, it's also about restoring the morale and integrity of the people that work at Eskom. And that is a process that I think we are making very good progress in. With regard to Miriam, the amount of outstanding funds, we estimate that there is a further 3 billion rand in irregular expenditure to recover at Kusile alone. After that, we will move on to contracts awarded for Medupi and Kusile. So the process will not stop. We don't intend to take our foot off the accelerator. And I want to echo what Minister Gordhan said. It would be preferable for those contractors who are aware that there has been defalcation and malfeasance to come forward and self-disclose. The alternative is that we will continue with our cooperation with the SIU, but also with entities offshore in order to ensure that they are brought to book. Entities with foreign listings, in particular in jurisdictions such as the United States, Frankfurt, Zurich, are particularly exposed, and we would therefore encourage them that if they are aware of irregular activity, to come forward. We are assisted by a global network of regulatory and law enforcement agencies who are determined and committed to assist South Africa in recovering funds lost due to state capture. So thank you very much, Kaiser.
Thank you. I think we are going closer to the end. I just want to check if there is a last round of questions that have been sent. Do you have anything on WhatsApp? Takalani?
Thank you. I have one question from...
Can you hold it? We can't hear you. Hold it, yeah.
The question is the SIU going to do the same with other multinational companies, particularly companies from China who are also implicated in the wrongdoing at the State Capture Commission of Inquiry? Thanks.
Where does it come from?
Comes from Sophie Mukwena from the SABC.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other from MS Teams?
Yes, the next one is from Antoinette Slabbert from Rapport. She would like to know, why do you need to have the contract reviewed and set aside? My understanding is that an illegal contract is to void, from the outset.
Okay. Let's try and finish the questions that we have.
And the next one is from Terence Creamer from Creamer Media. He'd like to know, besides the deviation request to allow ABB to complete the Kusile contract, will ABB face any other penalties at Eskom? In other words, will ABB be disallowed from bidding for other Eskom work? If so, what period? If not, why not?
Okay.
And the next one is from Alex Winning from Reuters. He wants to know, could you please state in simple terms what work ABB did at Kusile? What does control and instrumentation mean? Thank you.
Is that all?
And we actually have quite a few more. And Lamise Omarji from Fin24, she is asking, does Eskom believe the recoveries will make a dent in its 490 billion debt?
I think that was answered when Mr. de Ruyter was here, and he even gave percentages. Okay, let us try and answer. Advocate Mothibi, will you do the same to all the others?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Khanyaho. The question, is SIU going to do the same with other multinationals? The answer is an emphatic yes. We are investigating at various state institutions across government, in particular in other state-owned entities, and there are indeed those other contracts that involve multinationals, and we would like to categorically state that where the evidence points to wrongdoing or corrupt activities to those multinationals, we will in so many words do the same, because it is very important that we really demonstrate consequence management on at all levels on everyone, nationally or internationally. So, Ms. Sophie Mugwena, we will definitely continue to do that. And that is really what our investigations are focusing at. Why do we need to set the contract aside? There is a legal principle here that's applicable. The high courts have made decisions before. For those who understand the precedence of our law decisions, there's a case called Odekral. It's colloquially referred to as Odekral, but that decision affects all contracts that have been entered into, and the decision in that court case was that a contract remains valid until it is set aside by a court of law. So whilst the investigation revealed that this contract was entered into irregularly and with corrupt means, we are enjoined by law to take it through the legal process, to set it aside and cancel it. And of course, the next steps following the cancellation is the so-called legally just and equitable orders that will flow from there. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. de Ruyter. In simple terms, what did ABB do?
All right. I first want to just deal with Terence Creamer's question about whether it's possible to blacklist ABB throughout Eskom. ABB is a very large global company manufacturing a variety of control systems that Eskom has used for many years throughout its generation, transmission, and distribution system. It is embedded in how we run Eskom, and we obviously rely on ABB to service that equipment, to provide us with backup, and to replace equipment as it is necessary. Again, it's very similar to having decided on one particular brand of computer. It becomes very possible, very difficult and very expensive to switch away from that brand of computer once you've embedded yourself in the ecosystem of that manufacturer. So these are practical and commercial considerations that we will have to take into account as we consider the ramifications of the consequences of this unlawful conduct for future work by ABB. It is not an easy decision to make, because we may end up compromising Eskom's own systems if we act in a singular way, which we obviously want to try and avoid. In response to Alex's question, what does control and instrumentation mean? When you operate a power station, you have a distributed control system, DCS. This uses programmable logic chips, I hope that's simple enough, which can open and close valves or switches based on information provided to that particular PLC, as it's known, by an operator sitting behind a control panel, which gives an overview of the operation of a particular unit in a power station. So when the operator tells a unit to open or close a valve, he doesn't have to go out and physically do it. He interacts with the power station through the control and instrumentation system. So it's really the brains of the power station that was the subject of this particular contract. Does Eskom believe the settlement will make a dent in its debt? I think, as I've indicated during my speech, the amount is relatively modest in the bigger scheme of things. Even though it's a big number, and one doesn't want to be flippant about it, but our debt is our net debt is sitting at about 424 billion. We will be reporting results, by the way, on Monday, and we will give an update on our debt situation then. But I think what is quite important is that a settlement like this sends a very strong signal to contractors and suppliers of Eskom that we will hold them to account if they overcharge and if they try and purloin money from Eskom. And that principle in and of itself will allow us to negotiate better commercial outcomes for Eskom as we follow our procurement processes going forward, because contractors will know that the old days of taking advantage of corrupt and criminal activity are over, and that we now want to have the best possible value for the South African electricity consumer when we issue contracts. And in that sense, I think this is a very important precedent in setting the climate for contractors engaging with Eskom and also, I suspect, with other state-owned enterprises.
Thank you very much. I understood that there are still more questions there.
Questions? Can you
repeat the person?
Nicolette Pomper van Sail, ESI Africa Journal. What measures has Eskom taken to increase transparency and buffer against future manipulation of the tender process? And then Antoinette Slabbert from Rapport, this is for Mr. de Ruyter. The regulator NERSA has indicated that it will reconsider revenue determinations once the impact of corruption has been quantified. Do you expect NERSA to subtract these amounts from Eskom allowable revenue in the future?
Okay, is that all?
That's all it is.
What's up? You're fine? There's nothing, which means we will finish on time. Thank you very much. I think both questions are for you, Mr. de Ruyter.
Much. So there is a very strong focus in Eskom to improve our procurement processes. We are by no means perfect as yet. As has been stated before, it is difficult to overstate the extent to which processes and procedures were undermined. Undermined and hollowed out by agents of state capture. So in many instances, we have to rebuild from the ground up in order to ensure that there is adequate control over procurement. And that process is ongoing. To give an example, part of our procurement process is to use our Enterprise Resource Planning System, SAP, SAP, which is well known. And that system was deliberately undermined in order to allow for irregular procurement to take place. So rebuilding that capability and rebuilding that system takes quite some time in order to ensure that our procurement can now be done properly and ensuring that full value is obtained for the Eskom Rand. Antoinette, I fully expect that NERSA will deduct the recoveries from our efficient costs. We've consistently said that in our NERSA applications, we wish to be compensated in our tariffs for efficiently incurred costs. Where there are excessive costs, where there are costs attached to corruption and inefficiency, we as management take accountability for that, and we will sort out those costs from our system. But if you take account of the fact that over the past 10 years, NERSA decisions have led to a cumulative revenue gap for Eskom of some 300 billion rand, again, it is clear that the deduction of this type of settlement is unlikely to significantly change the case for higher and cost-reflective tariffs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think with all the questions are done, I just want to take this opportunity to check from our panelists if there's anyone, especially the ministers, who wants to have a say. From Minister Lamola, it's okay. Minister Gordhan?
Just a few words. The first thing for the media is to refer you to this booklet, which I hope you can see, prepared in August 2017 for the parliamentary inquiry into Eskom. It's on the web. Have a look at it. It will tell you the full story, well, part of the story of the malfeasance and the role players in that malfeasance in Eskom. And it gives you timelines when some of the major contracting actually happened and how it affected coal supplies, equipment supplies, and other issues like IT as well. The second, it's in that context that I want to reiterate the point made that this is not about playing up, as Mr. Advocate Mothibi said. This is a major advance and a major signal to culprits involved in malfeasance and corruption that it is possible for the state, notwithstanding the difficulties it has, to track people down and make sure that funds are actually recovered. I think the bigger problem is the patronage networks that develop around businesses and officials. And I think we need to start unpacking some of those patronage networks because they become part of the Bell Pottinger phenomenon that I referred to earlier on. To Miriam Issa's question around quantum, I think eventually this is going to run into tens of billions of rands, if not more, as we get on top of these issues. And as the capacity of the SIU and other law enforcement agencies that Minister Lamora is working on is actually increased. My last point is in relation to the tender system. The problems with the tender system don't lie only with Eskom. It also lies with the private sector that attempts to exploit at every instance, and here was an example, by whatever means they deem appropriate, weaknesses in the system or the manipulation of that system. So I think that there is also an appeal here to the business sector to review its ethics, to review its value systems, to review the business culture that we have in South Africa so that we can have a live and let live approach both for businesses and for government entities as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comment from the other panelists? Are we all okay? This then brings us to the end of our session. And we now, if there's any engagement that anyone would want to have, the spokespersons are all here. And we will be able to engage with you if you need anything over and above. Thank you very much for the day. Thank you.